Mainstream media exists for the purposes of indoctrination and manipulation of public perception. The world of free and independent media is growing, and with the upsurge in information now available in the public domain, it has never been easier to access free and independent media. The exploration of this information resulted in an experimental project which would provide a fully supported space for researchers, whistleblowers, and seekers of all kinds to express themselves and educate the world. On the 1st of January 2015, Conscious Consumer Network was launched to the world. Nobody thought we would make it this far, but CCN is the longest running free and independent media network of its kind. CCN is a unique collaboration of hearts and souls, bringing you information from different perspectives to educate and inform. Since we started CCN, we have had only one desire: the pursuit of a free, fair, just, sustainable world. And this has not changed. Having overcome many challenges over the last 2 years, CCN is here to stay, and we've got great things lined up for 2017.
It's all right to be just a little bit crazy.
Being creative is being a little bit crazy in just the right vibration. With that in mind, you should understand God's completely insane.
An educational comedy.
It's not a cause,
not a movement.
It's not a social group you can slap a label onto.
It's an idea. It's an intention.
It's an intuition.
A mindset in which reality can be explored.
A genuine expression.
Discernment.
Critical thinking and imagination.
To look inward upon ourselves.
To better understand the external world around us.
And yes,
few egos are bound to be bruised.
We are silly, strange, politically incorrect.
Your common building style of going about things.
Real and raw honesty.
Which invites you to be
you to the fullest.
Humanity lives in the sunlit world of what we believe to be reality. There is, however, unseen by most,
the military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist.
Wanting to know the truth requires risking what you already have and what you're already comfortable with, which is why most people don't want to know the truth.
We came, we saw, he died.
And just really brainwashed people.
This really stems from the fact that our society seems to have this trend of making the population feel like crap and then making money off of it. Some way. I mean, you could see this anywhere from cosmetics to weight loss industry to big pharma and selling medicine for depression.
They prescribe shit.
On this episode of Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy, we travel from Chicago to Warrenville, where Walter Kelso, Katie, Richard Reilly, and Dave Kelso take you on a tour of the full story of a police brutality incident in which the original cell phone footage is brief and begs many, many different questions and speculation. So in order to eliminate confusion, we bring you the full story. It's a harsh truth, but as tyranny becomes more transparent and the awakening process of humanity continues, people are quickly finding out that the cops do as they please regardless of the law, judges do as they please regardless of the law, and unless your last name is Clinton, then for as long as we can sense with our silence, those who are supposed to serve and protect have become nothing more than a gang of corporate policy enforcers. This video acts as further evidence that asking the question, am I free to go or am I being detained, will get you nothing more than physically abused by the police officer you will offend by having asked it.
Look at this. Look at this. Look. Warrenville, Illinois. Warrenville, Illinois Police Department.
Yes, it does. It matters to me. No, it doesn't.
This is, can I see your badge, please?
Yeah,
can I see your badge, please? Officer J. Denius. I'm just a civilian. Exercising my free will.
I got a cup. You put the phone down. You can keep it running. You can keep it running.
Sir, please.
You can keep it running.
This is so unnecessary.
You can keep it running.
Please don't do
put
this.
Put it down
to
on
me.
The ground.
Why are you hurting me?
Put it down. I'm not hurting
You're
you.
You're going to.
Not if I cuff you up. I'm not.
Why are you trying to do this? What if I have nothing on me, dude. I really, I don't want any.
Right now?
I just want to go home and not
put
have.
The phone down.
There's no need for trouble.
Put the phone
please,
down.
There's no need for
you
trouble.
You can leave it recording. Put
I don't.
The phone
I
down.
Don't even need to record you if you just let go of me. Please.
Everybody.
Please get off of me. This is going to be all over the internet, man.
I don't care. I'm in
you
the right.
You should care. You're not in the right. I'm not doing any harm, dude.
You haven't done anything.
I'm just trying to go in the water and have a nice day, dude.
I didn't form this. You guys have weed on you. It's illegal.
Dude, it's gone now. We have nothing on us. Please. Please. Yeah, this isn't. We have
exactly. Which is what I do.
Then give us a ticket.
Which is what I get.
We'll pay the ordinance ticket.
You guys are letting me talk.
Please.
No,
I will pay your ordinance. I will pay your ordinance. I'm not trying to run from you. Please don't hurt me. Please don't hurt my arm, man. I'm not.
You have the authority to tell me that I can't walk away or not listen to you.
Rich, come on, man. He's hurt. He's gonna hurt me, dude.
Yes, I do.
He's gonna fucking hurt my arm, dude.
Why? Why do you have your? Why are you restraining him like that? He's not doing anything.
I really don't want any problem with you, man.
Why are you restraining him?
I really don't.
Can you answer that, sir?
Please. I just want to go home, dude.
Why are you restraining him?
Please, sir. Why is this necessary?
He wasn't disking. He was
just a fucking human being, dude.
He's down from the main lot.
So unnecessary.
He hasn't been any kind of uncooperative. I just told you that you have no right to search me.
Please, sir. Please let go of me.
I'm done talking to you guys.
Why? This is.
I got another unit there. I'm gonna get all three of you in cuffs, and then we're gonna talk about it.
But what is that gonna solve?
It's not gonna happen.
What is that gonna solve? What is that going to solve? Can you please answer my question, sir?
That time
please.
Is over, dude.
Dude,
it's, over.
It's I'm not scared of what you're going to do to me, so please just tell me why this is necessary.
No. Put the paddle down.
Put the paddle down? What am I doing? I'm picking up my stuff so it doesn't end up in the water.
Please, sir.
Haven't done anything wrong.
I'm really just trying to enjoy the nice day.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, gosh.
I didn't know I needed a paddle pass.
Is this protecting and serving?
This isn't an
is
issue.
Is this protecting and are you proud of what you do? This is protecting and serving your freaking nation? Pathetic, man. Come on, I'm a kid and I know better. What does that feel like?
It's nothing, dude. I mean,
it's ridiculous.
What's the purpose of all this?
I know,
what the question
man.
Is.
Would you do this to your kids? What if this was your kid just trying to enjoy his day, man? What if this was your kid, dude?
You guys were talking about ordinance tickets.
I'm a child.
How it's just ordinance tickets. You guys were talking about that?
Yeah, we'll pay the ticket.
Exactly.
So why are we past that now? Turning it into
we
more.
Are past that.
You got too mad. You got all aggravated for no reason.
We haven't done anything.
We were staying calm and trying to talk it out. You're all mad.
We haven't done anything.
There's
no people been here. Other people been paddling by.
Because you're trying to argue and justify something that has no real reason.
You got angry because I walked away. I have the right to walk away. I haven't done anything wrong.
We're being unlawfully detained.
I gave you my information. I didn't even have to do that.
It's a common
law jurisdiction.
I'm
not doing anything wrong.
Put the phone down.
I will not put the phone down. This is a common law jurisdiction.
Then I can knock it. Then I'm going
to
knock it out of your hands,
why
and it might get bright
to me?
Because I'm going to handcuff you.
Why are you doing that? Why are you handcuffing him? He hasn't done anything wrong.
It's so unnecessary.
He hasn't done anything wrong. Why are you handcuffing? Why are you doing this?
Please stop.
Why?
Please.
Why? We're not doing anything wrong. Nobody's with. Nobody is fighting. Why are you forcing him to the ground? Why?
This guy needs to go in cuffs.
Why? What have I done? I haven't done anything wrong.
Turn around.
No. I have not done anything wrong.
Turn around.
I have not done anything wrong.
Turn around.
I have not done anything wrong. For what? For what? What are the charges? What are the charges?
He told me to come out and give you a hand.
Why are you putting your hands on us? We haven't done anything. You told us of our rights.
I don't want you guys walking around behind the head. You get over here. You guys are looking at it.
We haven't done anything wrong.
Every time.
We haven't done anything wrong.
I tell you to.
Well, why do we have to do what you tell us to?
He's got weed on him.
He isn't trying to do anything.
I don't want these guys walking around.
It's not. It doesn't matter if we're walking around. We have the free right
to
walk around.
No, it doesn't.
Can I see your badge, please?
I mean, you've asked for all our information. What's all yours? This is ridiculous. Like, we haven't done anything. You told us not to go out in the water, so we didn't. Why are you got your hands on everybody?
Please get off of me. This is gonna be all over the internet.
I don't care. I'm
why?
In the
right. We're not in the wrong. We haven't done anything.
We
were just trying to go in the water. You informed us that we were wrong.
You guys have weed on you.
I don't.
It's going.
Yeah, but wait. Maybe criminalize charges.
So why are you arresting him?
Some footage for Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy. We have my dad here for commentary, Walter Kelso, because he's a Vietnam veteran. And we have Richard Reilly. And Richard is going to explain a nice little blatant violation of his constitutional rights that happened right here. I'm just going to do a quick 360 so people can get a general view of the area. Hi, Katie.
Hi.
Okay. So, complete 360, we see the full scope of the area, and now I'm going to have Richard begin explaining and giving us the tour of what happened and exactly where.
Starting from here, this is where the one kid was coming out of the water that was already in the water with his raft. The person that the Forest Preserve officer was coming to approach in the first place.
Where did he come from?
He came from up here. The only way in here is down this path coming in. That's the only way to get into this area.
Okay.
There was no squad car or anything up there. He just walked in on foot. Now, I was over here getting ready to go into the water with my longboard, and there was another kid with me with a kayak. You're getting ready to go into the water over here. When the officer walked up, I was standing right here. He walked right past me. More than once, as I was standing here, he instructed the other kid to bring his raft up over here and set it down, and I just go ahead, told him to go ahead and listen to him. Bring it up, you know, and see what he wants to talk to you about. At that point, I walked back over here towards my longboard and the kayak, and was going to continue going about my business.
Okay, so you were going to launch right from here, and you had the boats laid in the water.
Well, there wasn't any water here at that point.
Yeah.
The water was much lower. The kayak and the longboard were sitting about over here by this rock where it's real shallow and there's gravel and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That's where they were sitting, pointing out, getting ready to go out into the water. As I walked back over here, the officer asked the one gentleman to sit down on the bench and wait for him. He set his raft down right here in the middle where he's instructed to. I continued to go back over here. The officer then broke away and left him sitting there, walked over here.
So that was the chair in the video that we saw him sitting.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes. And then he broke off, walked over here to speak to me and the other gentleman that were sitting here getting ready to go into the water. Not in the water yet, getting ready to go in the water.
Mm-hmm.
He informed us that you needed a paddle pass, which I had no idea what was, explained what it was, and that we needed life preservers on the crafts, which I didn't have. I, at that point, said, thank you for the information. I'm going to take my stuff and be on my way. Obviously, we're not going out in the water. We need to get some things taken care of first. I picked up my longboard and this little speaker that was inside, sitting on top of it, a Bluetooth speaker, showed them both to him that I didn't have anything on me, and continued to walk away. He then stopped me at that point and said he needed to search me. I said I'd decline the search. I set the longboard down right here. I emptied my pockets, which were these shorts right here. Adidas soccer shorts with these tiny little pockets in them that you can see through. All right. I was wearing these. No underwear, no shoes, no shirt, no anything. Just these shorts because I was getting ready to go out in the water.
Yeah.
And it was very obvious that I had nothing on me. I then
If he thought you were packing, take it as a compliment. He might swing the other way.
I'm not trying to go there, but
I know. Well, you know,
I had my phone in this pocket.
What was that officer's name again?
J. Dinas.
Oh, penis?
I'm not sure.
I got another.
Let's
name
be
for
serious.
Him.
I'm not trying.
Okay,
to,
I know.
I'm not
I just
make fun of the.
I know. Well, this is Paradigm Shift and educational comedy. I got to throw in a little bit here and there.
For them kind of people.
You know, I got to toss in a little bit.
Cell phone in a waterproof diving case in this pocket, which I took out and showed to him, and a little cigarette case that I kept my money in, kind of a wallet, a metal case that I kept, you know, my things in. I didn't have an ID on me. I explained that to him. I took it out. Held them up in the air and showed them, this is what I have. I have nothing, no weapons, nothing, not doing anything wrong. I'm going to be on my way. I then picked up my longboard and the speaker from right here and continued walking this direction. The officer then followed me, chased me down, and made me set my longboard down right here near the raft from the other gentleman, which he instructed to set down here. And then I didn't want to be bothered by him anymore, so I set down my longboard. And I continued walking down along the path down here. I walked down by the area where we began the video, and he then stopped following me and started walking back up here. And that's when I walked back up, because I wasn't trying to run away. I just didn't want to be chased by this guy. He had no reason to bother me. I had no idea what was going on. He had given me no reasons to bother me. So I walked back up. Was asking why he was putting this other gentleman in cuffs for a city ordinance violation, supposedly of, you know, having marijuana on him. I have no knowledge of this, so I don't know. So I ask. He said at that point on the video, which I had on my phone, which is very short, he had explained that he had weed on him in his exact words. I said, okay. Why are you placing him under arrest? That's all I asked.
Now, here's the thing, though. Ron was the one being arrested, right?
That was the other gentleman, Johnny. Ron was the one who walked up, because he followed me down here because he was flustered and didn't know what to do. He followed me, and he was walking back up with his phone when his video started, when I was already standing here with the officer in the general area.
So that kid who was saying, you know, why are you doing this to me? What's going on?
That was Ronnie. And
that was Ronnie.
I got a cuff. You put the phone down. You can keep it running. You can keep it running.
Sir, please.
You can keep it running.
This is so unnecessary.
You can keep it running.
Please don't do
put
this
it down
to me.
On the ground.
Why are you hurting me?
Put it down. I'm not hurting
You're
you.
You're going to.
Not if I cuff you up. I'm not.
Why are you trying to do this? What if I have nothing on me, dude. I really, I don't want any.
Right now?
I just want to go home and not
put
have.
Put the phone down.
There's no need for trouble.
Put the phone
please,
down.
There's no need for
you
trouble.
You can leave it recording. Put
I don't,
the phone
I
down.
I don't even need to record you if you just let go of me.
Why are you out of your hands on
please.
Everybody?
Please get off of me. This is gonna be all over the internet, man.
I don't care. I'm in the right.
You should care. You're not in the right. I'm not doing any harm, dude.
You haven't done anything.
He was standing right here with the officer at that point.
Yeah.
This explains the reason I said that the officer was impeding my path to leave, because he was.
Now, did Ronnie himself... He's right here. Did Ronnie himself have any weed on him, or was it just the other kid?
To my knowledge, no.
I'm just trying to go in the water. You have a nice day, dude.
I informed you. You guys have weed on you. It's illegal.
I don't know what he was doing. He was already separated from us anyway. He had gotten in the water and going along his way. I was planning on going that direction anyway. Just because we arrived in the same vehicle didn't mean that we were doing the exact same thing.
Right. Yeah.
So I don't know what his plans were. He had already gone on his way. I just called him back to tell him that he needed to put more air in his raft or he was going to sink. That's it.
Yeah.
And that is when the officer walked up. When he was coming out of the water, the officer walked right past me as I was walking back to my craft.
So here's a question. When the officer said he had weed on him, who is the he that the officer was referring to?
He was speaking of the other individual. His name was Johnny.
So he was not speaking about Ron?
No.
So it seems, at least from when I watched the videos, that the officer simply didn't like it that Ronnie was recording, so he nabbed him.
I can't guess what the officer was thinking.
Yeah, I'm just saying from, in my opinion, that's what it looked like.
The individual that he came and had whatever reasons to speak with was sitting here calmly waiting for him. That individual also got arrested for and charged with resisting arrest. All three of us did. For what, I still have no idea. Both on the videos, before and after, they never gave me any reason. To this date, I still don't know why I was under arrest. I was never given a reason.
And if I recall correctly, when you asked for a reason, the answer you were given is, because he said so.
On that video, yes.
Yeah.
He said so.
I've not done anything wrong. For what? For what? What are the charges?
I don't know. He told me to come out and give you a hint.
Because he said so isn't a charge.
No. Exactly. That's like not a charge, it's not a reason, and I had every valid right to question why I was being detained.
Yeah, so they're trying to sneak up and slap the cups on from behind you, and you're like, why am I doing that? What's the charge? And the answer you got is, well, because he said so.
He's supposed to tell him that he's under arrest and why he's arresting him.
He refused to do it.
And he should have called for a backup to come also and assist him, which he didn't.
That was also another lie that they told off camera. They tried to tell us that he wasn't responding to his radio, and that's why the other officers came in his defense. Well, that's obviously not true on the video. It was obvious that he was calling for defense and speaking, or calling for backup and speaking to them as they were arriving.
Yeah.
Exactly where he was.
He busted himself.
I really don't.
Can you answer that, sir?
Please. I just want to go home, dude.
Why are you restraining him?
Please, sir. Why is this necessary?
He wasn't disobeying.
I'm just a fucking human being, dude.
He's down from the main lot.
So unnecessary.
He hasn't been any kind of uncooperative. I just told you that you have no right to search me.
Please, sir, please let go of me.
I'm done talking to you guys.
Why? This is...
I got another unit there. I'm going to get all three of you in cuffs, and then we're going to talk about
it. But what is that going to solve?
So their reasoning set told that they explained to me when the Warrenville officer came and tried to place me under arrest, which is when the video stopped.
See, that's the part I didn't know. Now the whole thing makes way more sense to me. You got evidence on that guy, and that makes him nervous.
So... And then the interesting part happened after they stopped the videos that I was holding in my hands on the cell phones. That happened right here. When he came towards me, I was still standing near the other officer. The videos stopped. I then continued walking away from him and wouldn't allow them to detain me and put their hands on me until I was about right here. Then the officer grabbed, I was standing here like this with the phones in my hands, and the officer grabbed me by my elbows and went to pull my hands behind my back, and that's about what happened. I just went like that and said, why are you placing your hands on me? The other officer then, standing right about there, right about here, the other two, both Ronnie and Johnny, the other two gentlemen, were already sitting there on the bench in cuffs. And I was just standing here with the same questions. Why? Why are you placing me under arrest? Why are you trying to detain me? What have I done wrong? Because I haven't done anything.
Forest Preserve
please. Officer Dinas, let me explain this very quickly.
Okay.
Pulled out his can of pepper spray.
Ooh.
Go ahead.
Oh my God.
Didn't you say that this part wasn't on video, but you were standing there and they were trying to put the cuffs on you, but they could not pull your arms
like this and asked why. You have no reason for this.
And that's what they consider resisting.
Apparently.
Just because they were weak and you were strong.
I am not here to judge anything about that, but all I know is that's what happened.
Yeah. And just for fun, Dan, you're not exactly a weak person. Try to pull his arms apart. It's paradigm shift in educational comedy.
Like this? Yeah, he's a stout man.
Yeah, you
that's
can't.
What pissed him off.
You can't pull him back.
Yeah, that's what made him mad when he couldn't pull your arm back. Mm-hmm. You know, he should have tried to grab you by the wrist.
They grabbed me right here, and well, I was holding my phones, and at that point, I'm sure they didn't know that the recording had stopped.
Yeah,
but
normally they would grab you here and swing that arm back.
Yep, instead, he grabbed right here, and I just held my ground. I didn't submit. I just was asking why.
Now, just for the
fighting back. I didn't raise my hands in
any
way.
Yeah, I didn't try to hit him or push him away.
Yeah, now just for the PSEC audience here, so they have a little bit of background as to why you're so strong. He doesn't take steroids or anything like that. There are these health products he uses, these longevity health products, and they're totally legit. And we're going to have a little fun and prove this right quick. Lift up your shirt. I mean, this guy is built like a freaking tank. He's built like a tank. But, you know, he doesn't have muscles twice as big as his head. It's not steroids. It's just he puts nutrition into himself. And because the cops were, you know, your typical, you know, donut-eating diabetes candidates, they are a lot less healthier than him. So, obviously, he has that health advantage and thus a strength advantage.
Maybe that is the case. Like I said, I had my shirt off. I was wearing a pair of shorts. I mean,
yeah.
Maybe,
okay. Fine.
Maybe there was an intimidation factor. Yeah. I have no idea.
Fine. I'll give you a little. I'll put out a little. I'll put out a little disclaimer. The opinions of Dave Kelso or Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy are not necessarily the opinions of Richard Reilly. Okay. Legal disclaimer issued. You can like calm down about that now. So you got your ass completely pepper sprayed. Okay. Show us.
Can of pepper spray standing right about there.
How much is he going to hurt you?
The other officer was still holding on to my elbow, standing right behind me. He then began to spray me from right there. I then, at that point, just went like this. Blocked my face. I don't know what happened. I broke the grip of the officer, I'm sure. I didn't really think about it at the time. I was getting pepper sprayed. So I went up like this to protect my face, and then immediately went down to the ground and covered up like this. I was not resisting in any way. The officer then continued to spray the whole can of pepper spray in my hair,
Jesus.
All over my back, all over, completely drenching my whole body in it.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I still have some of the jewelry that I was wearing sitting out that I have to bring in and submit, you know, a complaint and a report with the Warrantville Police Department showing how all my jewelry was damaged by the pepper spray, how there's still residual leftovers on it. After what happened after the fact.
Wasn't there other property damage?
I'll tell you exactly how the fire department had to hose me off with their truck because I had so much pepper spray.
Wasn't there other property damage you experienced?
Yeah, there was. I mean, that's after the fact. There's nothing at this point in the story.
Okay.
Like I said, at this point I was laying there. At that point, they picked me up, brought me over to this area, which was closer to the other gentleman, sat me down right here. I was still laying and covering up because I was burning. And I sat down, I got to down on my knees right here. They then cuffed me.
He's too fast.
And pulled my cigarette case and my phone out of my pocket. Or my phone was in my hand, cigarette case out of the pocket with my money enclosed. And placed me under arrest. They then sat me here in the blazing 90 plus degree heat. Blazing sun. Completely drenched in pepper spray, which I trust me, is much worse than putting any sort of tanning oil on you. I sat here roasting, burning. I felt like I was in hell's fire.
Yeah.
And I do not take that lightly. I was burning to death. It was horrible. All the other than paramedics and Warrenville police officers, there had to have been a group of 16 officials and individuals, whether they were from Edwards Hospital or the paramedics or the fire department and the Warrenville Police Department, were all standing around here in a group wondering why I was being treated as such.
Yeah, so word to the wise for anybody who thinks they're gonna get cute and be a badass with the cops at protests and stuff, it is not fun to get pepper sprayed, and these Gestapo motherfuckers are more than happy to spray your ass up just for fun. So be smart, don't be stupid, don't antagonize the cops, and don't get yourself pepper sprayed at frickin' protests, because they are happy to pepper spray you. So unless you want to feel hellfire, as he's describing, then be intelligent and don't be an idiot. Do your activism safely.
With that being said, I wasn't antagonizing the cops. I wasn't doing anything out of line. I was simply asking what the reasoning was for detaining and trying to place me under arrest.
Yep, like I said, they just love spraying people.
You should have never
been arrested.
And
antagonizing the officers is a completely different thing.
Yeah.
You should have never been arrested at all. That you haven't done anything wrong. I understand about the other chap because he had something illegal on him.
Supposedly.
But as far as you're concerned, he had nothing illegal on you. He didn't do anything wrong.
From that point, like I said, they sat me.
Thank you.
Right here for quite a while, until I made it quite clear that I was dying. They Ooh. Needed to do something. Then they attempted to wipe my face off. The paramedics attempted to wipe my face and rinse my eyes the best they could. When they realized that wasn't doing it, it was way beyond that point. It was so bad, it was ridiculous. Then the officers agreed to allow the paramedics and the fire department to bring me up the path towards the parking lot where all the Warrenville police vehicles and the fire department vehicles and the EMS vehicles were all up here in plain sight. I could see them, which is why I questioned in the first place who this gentleman was who just walked up and started demanding.
Yeah, because this fence right here, this is the parking lot. Just to illustrate to the viewers what's up. This is the parking lot.
So this is where all the vehicles were.
Yep. Yeah, well,
they stopped me right here with the hose from the fire truck.
All right, one sec. Let me just, So this is where the vehicles were. We can clearly see that from back down where we were, when there's police cars parked there, it's pretty fucking obvious. So when Officer Tiny Cock approached, there was no squad car or anything.
All right, so at this point, I was in cuffs, hands behind my back, and they proceeded to spray me with the fire truck from the fire hose for approximately 15 minutes with a break in the middle, because in the midst of being on fire physically from the surface, being sprayed from the fire truck is extremely cold, and I began shivering and freezing from the inside.
Mm-hmm.
So I was freezing and on fire at the same time. It was quite unpleasant. So I stopped him for a break in between and then had him continue spraying me again because it was that bad. And still after that, there's huge piece residues and things and tarnishment and other signs of deterioration on the jewelry from all the pepper spray.
Mm-hmm.
You can still clearly see blotches of it sitting on some of the things. And that's after I was sprayed by a fire truck. All right. At this point, that was about it. They walked me back up and placed me in the vehicle and took me to the county jail. In which case, I sat there for about 12 hours and was still never explained why I was under arrest in the first place.
That's pretty screwed.
And then if you want to see where I believe the officer came from, pan down to the bridge going across over there. There's another little side entrance from a dead end road back over that way. I believe that's probably where the officer came from in the first place.
So down the bridge that way.
Across the bridge and up along this pathway down the side where these nice folks over here are walking down towards. So I believe he walked up around that way and came up.
So back over that way is a road where he was parked, and you assume he walked his ass across to get to this part.
And then walked up on us, and that's why at this point when he was harassing us, I started questioning who he was and wanted to see some form of ID because I saw no vehicle.
And he was just some joker that could have bought a uniform at a supply store.
Well, the other problem with this so-called cop is that you didn't have any ID, so that worried him.
I told him exactly who I was and let him run my name.
That doesn't matter. They have to run it
yep.
and everything, and he didn't do that. But that was another problem with him. Mm-hmm. You had no idea, he didn't know, at least he would have something to know who you are and where you live.
Yeah, I freely offered that information. He had,
and
you know,
you,
could
for all he's concerned, for all he's concerned, you could be some kind of terrorist, some
and
illegal.
I even told him that I live, which is the absolute fact, right across the woods on the other side of this whole compound, and I've
been here,
and I've been rafting in this river for 20
he's
plus
not gonna
years.
Buy, he's not going
to buy Never have
it.
I ever had anybody question me or say anything to me before.
He's not going to buy that, and he's also looking to harass you, so he's going to do everything he can to piss you off.
Hey, remember that one time, Dad? The cops were over at our corner.
Oh yeah, they tried to piss me off.
And they, no, and they thought that there was a fight gonna break out,
oh, yeah.
But everything was ended up being peaceful.
Yeah.
You know, we resolved things with.
They weren't happy with that. They
yeah, they actually said that they were upset that there was no fight, that they live for busting heads,
yeah.
and they said that if they get called out again and it's peaceful, everyone's going to jail.
Yeah.
That's like Gestapo. That is not cops as we're taught how cops behave.
Well, when you give somebody some authority, there's a lot of time that goes to their head.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this guy's out here, and this is like his rule. Mm-hmm. Okay? This is his place of business.
I see.
And now, he doesn't have this special license for his paddles, so he's thinking, oh, this guy's pulling my leg.
And he's the king.
It all adds up and it starts snowballing, and then now you back off from him. Now, in his mind, you're resisting. You're trying to get away. You are guilty.
That was in his own words. He said he was upset. I forgot to mention that. He was upset because I wasn't obeying him.
Oh, yeah.
Yet all I asked was, why should I obey you? What's your...
And there's no proof that he's even a cop.
It doesn't matter because he has authority.
But he refused to show ID to him. He refused to identify himself. For all Richard knew, he was just some wacko.
And as far as his authority goes, he had informed me of the rules. I had no complaints, and I said, all right, well, then I'll take my things and be on my way.
Yeah, because you never even got into water yet.
At that point, I'm not sure why he had any reason to speak to me, and that's why I declined the search, and that's why I declined to speak to him anymore after that. And he got upset and started using force.
Well, he's the king, and he wanted to bring his wrath down on a peasant,
a license or an ID card for your paddling, why isn't it posted? Why don't they post
that
it? Why don't they post
question.
It up here? They post everything else up there.
That is a good question.
They didn't post that up there. Why? Why didn't they post that? Hey, it's part of the law. That's what I don't like about our laws. There's a lot of laws that are made. We don't know what the hell they are. And now you come down and you do something, now you're breaking that law and you didn't know. And right away, they're going to hammer you.
Mm-hmm.
And
yep.
That's what I don't like about this kind of garbage.
It's Nazism, it's Gestapo.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. But this guy that he had to deal with was a real you-know-what, and he just wanted to cause this guy more trouble. He didn't like the way he looked, he didn't like the way his hair was, he didn't like anything about this man, so he decided he would do something.
And I hope when you go to court that
I
hope when you go to court the judge watches this whole video.
Exactly what he did.
I'm sorry.
I hope when you go to court that the judge watches this whole video, because I'm putting it online.
The judge has got to take it into consideration that this officer was way beyond. This man was doing nothing wrong. It'd be understandable if he was out there tearing up trees or ripping stuff up or, you know, doing some damage to the place, but he was doing nothing wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So why would you even approach him? Why would he even bother you?
Yep. And to make it clear, because I don't want anybody to ever take this the wrong way, I have a wonderful relationship with many of the Warrenville police. This is not an attack on the police or even the Forest Preserve officers. Unfortunately, there are certain individuals that misuse and abuse their power and authority.
Yep.
And in my opinion, this is a blaring case of it.
Mm-hmm.
So he decided to take it out on him.
Yeah, all I had done was ask our constitutional right was why he was using force, why he was placing people under arrest. These are simple tickets, ordinance violations. He could write the ticket,
yeah,
do what he has to do, and everybody goes on their way.
Please.
Charges, it's tickets.
Yeah, this isn't. We have
exactly.
Which is what I do.
Then give us a ticket. We'll
which
pay
is
the
what
ordinance.
I get.
We'll pay the ordinance ticket.
You guys are
letting
me talk.
That, please.
Well, no,
I will pay your
physical.
Ordinance. I will pay
you
your
guys
ordinance.
Are walking away. And not
I'm not trying to run from you. Please don't hurt me. Please don't hurt my arm, man. I'm not. I'm not
to tell me that I can't walk away or not listen to you.
Rich, come on, man. He's hurt. He's gonna hurt me, dude.
Yes, I do.
He's gonna fucking hurt my arm, dude.
Why? Why? Why you have your? Why are you restraining him like that? He's not doing anything.
I really don't want any problem with you, man.
Why are you restraining him?
I really Brandy don't.
Can you answer that, sir?
Please. I just want to go home, dude.
Why are you restraining him?
Please, sir. Why is this necessary?
He wasn't disking. He was
I'm just
was
a fucking human being, dude.
Time.
Down from the main lot.
So unnecessary.
He hasn't been any kind of uncooperative. I just told you that you have no right to search me.
Please, sir. Please let go of me.
I'm done talking to you guys.
Why? This is...
I got another unit there. I'm going to get all three of you in cuffs, and then we're going to talk about it.
But what is that going to solve?
It's not going to happen.
What is that going to solve? What is that going to solve? Can you please answer my question, sir?
That time
please.
Is over, dude.
There is no reason for any of this excessive force. Definitely no reason for pepper spray.
This guy didn't want that. He wanted to cause some damage, and he did.
And though I don't have the pepper spray on the video, like I said, there was at least 12 to 15 officials from different respective facilities that were here and witnessed the aftermath of it. Nobody actually saw them physically pepper spraying me, except for obviously the officer who did it and the one Warrenville officer that was
the
first
and
responder.
And the two traps that he was arrested.
And the two individuals in handcuffs. After that, everybody definitely saw the aftermath, so there's no denying it. And I'm sure if there's any sort of accountability in the police department that they have to account for the fact, just like if they discharge the weapon, they have to account for that bullet. I sure hope they have to account for the can of pepper spray that was used, and that again...
No, it'll cover it up.
Should show, you know, like I said, that
it'll
I'm
probably
being
all
completely
become,
and 100% truthful in this.
Well, you know what?
The judge will just throw when it the, out and what? Say, well, okay, you know, be a good boy, and probably say, make sure you have a license for your paddle and carry an ID with you. That's probably all it'll be.
Unless the judges are dicks too.
No, they don't care. This is petty.
Yeah, but it depends on their moods.
Yeah, I understand that. But today, the way the system works, they want to get through and get you out of there as quick as possible. Okay, you didn't do nothing wrong. Fine, get the hell out of here. That's basically the way it works. Unless you got some money and a good lawyer and you can sue the hell out of them, you know. Most people don't. Most people can't take it that far because they stall and stall and it costs more money and more money. We can't afford that. And they play it. And I've seen it many, many times.
And we unfortunately pay for both sides
because yeah.
Their end gets paid by our tax
exactly.
dollars. So they don't care. It's not their money.
Exactly. Well, this is petty. The judge is just going to just throw it out. He did nothing wrong.
It should be the case. Sometimes I wonder.
You still have to go back, right?
Yep. Still have court. Yep. And you know, like I said, I mean the obvious, what should be common sense is that this should not have happened in the first place. That's why I have my doubts with the judicial system.
Exactly.
Because this should never even gotten to this point.
Exactly.
It's absolutely ridiculous.
Exactly.
I mean, our constitutional rights are very clear.
If this man would have felt you were a threat, why didn't he call regular authorities, the regular police to come in on this, you know, back me up here.
Mm-hmm.
And then you would have went with the regular police and everything would have been
then
fine.
When they did, unfortunately their reason was because this guy said so.
Why? What have I done? I haven't done anything wrong.
Turn around. I have not done anything wrong.
For what? For what? What are the charges? What are the charges?
He told me to come out and give you a hint.
He's like, well, I'm going to need a better reason than that.
Well, you know next time,
it doesn't mean
you call the police.
If you're walking down the street and an officer says, stop, place your hands behind your back, you're under arrest, he has to give you a reason.
Right.
They can't just stop you and tell you're under arrest
right.
because I said so.
Right.
This is here where we have the major problem. Why am I under arrest? I haven't done anything wrong because he said so.
You know, that's like our photo enforced. On the books, it says that the only people that can issue you a ticket is a man in uniform and a gun. And he's a police officer, not some company sending you out a ticket. This is all illegal. But they know how to rob people. They make their own laws. And that's that's the bad part about our country and what's going against the citizens.
Yeah, Sieg Heil, Fourth Reich.
If you...
Unfortunately, we're seeing a blaring example of it in the 2016 presidential election.
Papers, please.
This is what I'm going through for asking what I did wrong. How does one Hillary Clinton get away with destroying evidence after a congressional subpoena?
Well, that's...
We all know I'd be sitting in jail because I didn't even do anything, and I sat in jail.
Well, that's easy. No reasonable prosecutor who doesn't want to end up suicided would ever bring such a case, as James Comey said.
You're going to use the excuse that search and seizure thing, that you didn't want them to touch you, so therefore you're automatically guilty. I'm telling you right now, they're going to hit you up with that. You did not let them frisk you, so you are guilty.
Oh, I showed them everything. I just didn't want their hands on me for no reason.
He's got to physically check you to see if you have anything
They didn't ask me to do that either.
He has to protect himself.
He just told me to put my hands behind my back to cuff me. He didn't ask me for anything else.
They have to protect themselves, so they usually want to frisk you to make sure you don't have a gun somewhere where they can't see.
That was very obvious.
Yeah, you got nothing.
I was wearing nothing, was very clear in the videos. You could see through everything.
This guy just looks like, this sounds like this guy's just a big troublemaker and he wants his power.
Plain and obviously unarmed as one human being could be while having any form of clothing on.
But like
the
I
only
said,
thing less would have been completely naked.
He didn't like you.
And that's illegal. I couldn't do that.
He doesn't like your beard. He doesn't like your hairstyle. He doesn't like what you have to say.
Well, it's also...
And therefore, he's going to come down on you.
It's also very obvious that the superiority complex that Officer Penis has is a psychological overcompensation for the inferiority complex that is, in my opinion, about his tiny winky.
You know, that's not what I went to war for.
This is a good example.
I did not go to war for the crap we got here today.
Papers, please, Kyle.
And I went to war because they told me it was for freedom. It was to take care of our country. That the people I was fighting against were our enemies.
No, it's for the good of the office of penises in the Reich.
Why would I have to come home and see all this crap and hear everything that's going on? It's sickening. It's sickening.
Because your Lord and Savior Obama says so. Let me hear an amen, brothers and sisters.
No, it's really sickening. Mm-hmm. Because you come home proud that you've helped out this country, and you get a slap in the face now. And I'm telling you, all veterans today think the same way. Every one of them, every one of us, think the same way about this country and about authority here. And then look, now I have Agent Orange. I've gone through the chemo. Now I'm going through radiation. You know, I don't feel bad about it. I did my job when I went into the service. I'm a proud man. And that's the way it is. And I would do it again. I have no qualms with protecting my country.
I feel the absolute same way. I'm a proud patriot, and that means I have allegiance to my people and my country. Not necessarily my government, my people and my country.
No, right. God exactly. And country is the big thing. Government's kind of sloppy.
They've become a domestic enemy.
What are you going to do? Hey.
We could follow up. I mean, we could do follow up.
And depending on the judge you get,
we're pretty okay with it.
If the judge is going to take in effect what you're saying, if the judge is going to be on the same route. Yeah.
The last thing is the shit that got damaged.
You're not dressed according to their statues. It's a hard call.
Hey, Richard, the shit that got damaged. Explain that.
That happened all after the fact. That was when they took wouldn't allow me to have somebody come and pick up my property again, since my home is right through the woods over there, less than a quarter of a mile. I could have easily called somebody to pick up my equipment, to walk it back or drive it back to the house. They wouldn't allow it. They said that they were going to take it and store it for safekeeping.
And they tore it apart instead.
They did. They drug it up. It's all scratched. The things were absolutely brand new. This was the first time I was attempting to put them in the water. They're all scratched up, decals are missing off of them, things were unscrewed, taken apart, that say directly on the instructions to never unscrew these because now it's not watertight. And these things, nothing was locked. There was nothing on any of the things. There was absolutely nothing for them to search. I had no problem with them searching everything. You know, it's a kayak. It's got a watertight lock on it. You spin it and open it and you can look inside the compartment. They instead took all the screws out that kept everything water sealed. Now it leaks. The claims that had already been filed with the Forest Preserve about the damage to the property, and also had a pair of sunglasses that were Oakley sunglasses, polarized, that were on my head, sport glasses, because I was going out to do sport type of things. They were on my head clearly in the video. We're not checked into any evidence. We're not checked into any property list, and I lost a pair of sunglasses somehow through this ordeal, along with a couple other pieces of property that were either damaged or lost in the exchange, including cash, which is kind of funny. And the Forest Preserve openly returned a small amount of cash to Ronnie, but then said they knew nothing about the cash of mine that was, you know, unaccounted for.
So, Mr. Superiority Complex appears allegedly to have jacked your wallet.
Well, I didn't get that returned either. That's another question.
They jacked the whole wallet.
Little metal case that I kept my... Normally would keep my credit cards and ID and everything in. Only had cash in it because I was going out in the water and I had no reason to bring credit cards and ID. So right. I just took all that stuff out and left it on the counter at home.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and just left the cash in there. That's all that was in there. Yeah, as far as, you know, there was no identification.
Well,
no,
it's too bad you didn't have that in your
And that vehicle. Hasn't been returned either. I mean, it was just a little folding metal case, what would appear to be like a cigarette case. It was like nothing. That wasn't returned either, but again, that's not of real any monetary value itself either. Not saying he stole it, I just don't know what happened to it. Yeah, I can give you the explanation for the cash missing. This was kind of comical too, and just shows the complete... incompetence of this whole situation and whole situation, the whole arrest, the whole everything. The reason that was given for returning a small amount of cash to Ronnie is because the officer had fully admitted leaving some of our property on top of the vehicle and driving away with it. That was the reason for having to return the small amount of cash. Yet they argue with me when I said other things were missing, and including cash of mine. Kind of funny how that works. One of the three individuals' stuff was left on the vehicle and driven away with. And then again, when we went to claim all the properties, everybody's property was mixed up. There was stuff of mine and their property. There was stuff of theirs and my property. So there was obviously no separation. They just dumped everything in bags and put names on them. So how can they tell us that there's no possible chance that anything else got lost or damaged? Just the $10 that they returned to Ronnie.
Joke on you, huh?
Yeah. Well,
at the Forest Preserve office.
Well, because according to the law, a police officer's word holds way more priority than yours. So if they want to lie, then their lies are the truth in the eyes of the law.
Unfortunately, it goes that way
and
quite often.
There's no checks and balances against it. If a cop's going to lie about you, you're fucked. Oh. Their word is gospel and they are Jesus Christ.
It's a good thing I did have the wherewithal to, at some point, at least start the videos on the cell phones. Because there's no reason for them at the beginning. The officer informed us of the rules of going out in the water. I said, fine, we got to go. I had no need to start a video recording until he continued to harass us in the aftermath, and that's where it picked up on the videos. And then, of course, my video, as I said on the caption, my memory on my phone ran out, so it was really short. And then the other one stopped as the officers tried to put their hands on me without explaining why.
Definitely some crazy shit.
Last time I checked, per the Constitution, you have the right to your own personal space. They have to have a reason to invade upon that space.
People need to wake up to the fact that the reason they call it the American Dream is because you have to be asleep to believe it. The cops are not like Superman, and the criminals are not like the Joker. The criminals are running government, and the minions from the Despicable Me movies are running local government, and then we are just obeying the tyranny. Silence is consent, and we are consenting to getting our asses kicked.
The beyond all without any written or verbal authorization submitting our personal rights. Every single individual on this planet has the right to their own personal being, and that cannot be violated, again, without proper reasoning.
Mm-hmm. Not just because, hi, I'm Hitler and I want to manhandle you today, go fuck yourself. Eat my dick.
And the really sad part is the really heartfelt part from your father there, and I feel for all the veterans. I mean, this is really disgraceful. This is really disgraceful, what they fought for and what they're being put through, and they see the aftermath of what they got out of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, having, you know, cancer and everything else aside, but to see that the rights of the individuals that they fought for the freedom for being violated as such is just despicable.
It's like they thought they were fighting against the Nazis, and come to find they're fighting for the Nazis. That's the betrayal. That's the feeling of betrayal.
In many cases.
Yep. I think we can end off with that.
Much love to everybody.
Although some people are awake, there still seems to me that, I know this is controversial, so I'm just going to say it right out. If you have a passion, you're not awake. That's what I do. Okay? You can't claim to be an awake and aware person and lack compassion. So, for example, yes, there are people, you know, and there's lots to be said about this and that and the next thing, but there's compassionate ways in which to go about it rather than attacking. And we as a society, and I've noticed this program, and it's so sad because you've got a lot of these truth speakers, truth seekers waking up, coming into this movement, you know, jumping into the communication mix on various social media platforms, and they've got what I call the Jesuit punitive programming. Okay, which is if someone's done something bad, you know, they must be punished, even if it's a verbal lashing. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking that it really is about isolating this punitive aspect of our thinking of, you know, damage and retribution. You know, if you're in pain, you've got to seek vengeance kind of thing. And there is very much this thing inside the human psyche. And I suppose it does take a lot of calm, discipline, I don't know, yogi awareness, whatever you want to call it, you know, sit in silence, whatever you have to do to rid yourself of that anger and come to a place where, you know, even though you've been hurt, you don't project your pain onto others. Rather, you show compassion and empathy for the pain of others because you've suffered too. Yeah. That for me is awareness. Okay. It's not, you know, let's get our pitchforks out and let's go, you know, kill these guys because they're bad.
Don't forget the fake positive.
Yeah.
I'm positive, see? Don't you dare tell me otherwise, or you're of a low frequency. Energy is attached to you. If you tell me I'm not positive,
you know.
Exactly. I get this all the time with where people say, oh, why do you focus on such negative stuff? Because, you know, a lot of the work we do is exposing the darkness. And I love what you said there. It's not that I focus on the darkness. I'm a very happy, positive person because guess what? I shine light into dark places. For me, that's a positive, positive, positive. That's not a negative, negative, negative. It is absolutely about putting positive into a bad situation to manifest a positive outcome, which hopefully is awareness of the situation.
Yeah, totally, totally.
You can roughly locate any community in the world somewhere along a scale running all the way from democracy to despotism. One to the democracy end, another somewhere in the middle, and a third. Let's find out about despotism. This man makes it his job to study these things.
Well, for one thing, avoid the comfortable idea that the mere form of government can of itself safeguard a nation against despotism. Germany, under President Hindenburg, was a republic. And yet in this republic, an aggressive despotism took root and flourished under Adolf Hitler. When a competent observer looks for signs of despotism in a community, he looks beyond fine words and noble phrases.
For which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Many observers have found that two workable yardsticks help in discovering how near a community is to despotism. The respect scale and the power scale. A careful observer can use a respect scale to find how many citizens get an even break. As a community moves towards despotism, respect is restricted to fewer people. A community is low on a respect scale if common courtesy is withheld from large groups of people on account of their political attitudes. If people are rude to others because they think their wealth and position gives them that right, or because they don't like a man's race or his religion. Equal opportunity for all citizens to develop useful skills is one basis for rating a community on a respect scale. The opportunity to develop useful skills is important, but not enough. The equally important opportunity to put skills to use is a further test on a respect scale. A power scale is another important yardstick of despotism. It gauges the citizen's share in making the community's decisions. Communities which concentrate decision-making in a few hands rate low on a power scale and are moving towards despotism. Like France under the Bourbon kings, one of whom said, "The state, I am the state." Today, democracy can ebb away in communities whose citizens allow power to become concentrated in the hands of bosses.
What I say goes, see? I'm the law around here.
The test of despotic power is that it can disregard the will of the people. It rules without the consent of the governed. Look beyond the legal formalities of an election in measuring a community on the power scale to see if the ballot is really free. If the citizens can vote only the way they're told, a community approaches despotism. When legislatures become ceremonial assemblies only and have no real control over lawmaking, their community rates low on a power scale. In a downright despotism, opposition is dangerous whether the despotism is official or whether it is unofficial.
The spread of respect and power in a community is influenced by certain conditions, which many observers measure by means of the economic distribution and information scales.
If a community's economic distribution becomes slanted, its middle income groups grow smaller, and despotism stands a better chance to gain a foothold. Where land is privately owned, one sign of a poorly balanced economy is the concentration of land ownership in the hands of a very small number of people. When farmers lose their farms, they lose their independence. This one can stay on, but not as his own boss anymore. To the extent that this condition exists throughout a nation, the likelihood of despotism is increased. In communities which depend almost entirely on a single industry, such as a factory or mine, maintaining economic balance is a challenging problem. If this condition exists over the nation as a whole, so that the control of jobs and business opportunities is in a few hands, despotism stands a good chance. Another sign of a poorly balanced economy is a taxation system that presses heaviest on those least able to pay. A larger part of a small income is spent on necessities such as food.
Sales taxes on such necessities hit the small income harder. In the days of the salt tax, feudal despotisms were partly sustained by this and other effects. A community rates low on an information scale when the press, radio, and other channels of communication are controlled by only a few people, and when citizens have to accept what they are told. In communities of this kind, despotism stands a good chance. See how a community trains its teachers.
Bear this in mind. Young people cannot be trusted to form their own opinions. This business about open-mindedness is nonsense. It's a waste of time trying to teach students to think for themselves. It's our job to tell them.
And when teachers put such training into practice, despotism stands a good chance. These children are being taught to accept uncritically whatever they're told. Questions are not encouraged.
How can you ask such a question? Have you got a textbook?
Yes, ma'am.
Doesn't it say here that our law courts are always just?
Yes, ma'am.
Then how dare you question the fact? Sit down.
And so we aren't surprised when...
But it must be true. I saw it in this book, right here.
And if books and newspapers and the radio are efficiently controlled, the people will read and accept exactly what the few in control want them to. Government censorship is one form of control. A newspaper which breaks a government censorship rule can be suspended. It is also possible for newspapers and other forms of communication to be controlled by private interests.
I thought I told you to kill that story. It'll cost us a lot of advertising.
If that story goes out, I quit.
All right.
What sort of community do you live in? Where would you place it on a democracy despotism scale? To find out, you can rate it on a respect scale and a power scale. And to find out what way it is likely to go in the future, you can rate it on economic distribution and information scales. The lower your community rates on economic distribution and information scales, the lower it is likely to rate on respect and power scales, and thus to approach despotism. What happens in a single community is the problem of its own citizens. But it is also the problem of us all. Because as communities go, so goes the nation.
On the train with $200. He couldn't see any harm in a friendly game of cards. What if the other men were strangers? And take Joe Collins. He's got a nice wife at home. But he met this girl at the bar, and she looked after the first couple of drinks. There's a good old-fashioned word for people like this. We call them suckers. And there are other people. People who stay up nights figuring out how to take away what they've got. There are all kinds of games. Mike here, for instance. He's got everything in me. He's young. He's healthy. got a job. And he's got a plenty of food. Big factories to make things a man can use. Big cities to do the business of a big company. And people. Lots of people. Enough to work the farm and build the factories. Dig the mines. Run the business. All kinds of people. People from different countries with different religions. Different colored skins. Free people. They can live together and work together and build America together because they're free. Free to vote, to say what they please, go to their own churches, to pick their own jobs. Yeah, Mike's got something, all right. He's got America. But there are guys who stay up nights figuring out how to take that away from him.
I happen to know the facts. Now, friends, I'm just an average American. But I'm an American American. And some of the things I see in this country of ours make my blood boil. I see people with foreign acclimony. I see Negroes holding jobs that belong to me and you. Now, I ask you, if we allow this thing to go on, what's going to become of us real Americans?
I've heard this kind of talk before, but I never expected to hear it in America.
This fella seems to know what he's talking about.
What are we real Americans going to do about it? You'll find it right here in this little pamphlet. The truth about Negroes and foreigners. The truth about the Catholic Church.
But do you believe in that kind of talk?
I don't know, makes pretty good sense to me.
And I tell you, friends, we'll never be able to call this country our own until it's a country without. Without what? Yeah, without what? Without Negroes. Without alien foreigners. Without Catholics. Without Freemasons.
You know these Masons. What's wrong with the Masons? I'm a Mason. Hey, that fella's talking about me.
And that makes a difference, doesn't it?
These are your enemies. These are the people who are trying to take over our country. Now you know them. You know what they stand for. And it's up to you and me to fight them. Fight them and destroy them before they destroy us. Thank you.
Before he said Masons, you were ready to agree with him.
Well, yes, but he was talking about... What about those other people?
But in this country, we have no other people. We are American people.
What about you? You aren't American, are you?
I was born in Hungary, but now I am an American citizen. And I have seen what this kind of talk can do. I saw it in Berlin.
What were you doing there?
I was a professor at the university. I heard the same words we have heard today. But I was a fool then. I thought Nazis were crazy people, stupid fanatics. But unfortunately, it was not so. You see, they knew that they were not strong enough to conquer a unified country. So they split Germany into small groups. They used prejudice as a practical weapon to cripple the nation. Of course, that was not easy to do. They had to work hard to do it. You see, we human beings are not born with prejudices. Always they are made for us, made by someone who wants something. Remember that when you hear this kind of talk. Somebody is going to get something out of it, and it isn't going to be you. This is not classroom theory. I saw it happen. I saw it first in Berlin in 1932. Five young men that I knew were standing in the crowd listening to the Nazi speaker. Eric was a Catholic. Anton, a student of mine, was a Jew. Heinrich owned a small hardware store. Karl was a farmer. And Hans was an unemployed metal worker.
To all Bavarian Germans, I say it is time you inherited the nation which rightfully belongs to you. To you alone belongs the glorious destiny of the greater Germany. The Nazi Party will provide land for the farmer, work for the worker, and profits for the small businessman. Who is getting these things now? The Jew. The Jew who has stolen our nation and our birthright. who makes all the money and takes all our jobs. The Jew, he must be shunned. He must be ostracized. He must be eliminated. And the Catholics, we don't want our great nation run by a foreign church. We Germans will know what to do with these people when the time comes. They and their faith must be destroyed. Then there are the Freemasons. In Germany, we have no place for secret societies. There will be only one society, and that is the Nazi Party. There will be no secrecy about that in the new Greater Germany.
One by one, he attacked each minority, and he split them off one from the other. These men were all fellow Germans when they came here today. Now they were split into rival groups, suspicious of each other, hating each other. They were being swindled, all of them. But the man who was really being fooled was Hans. He was pure German, according to Nazi standards. To him they promised everything, and he fell for it. That's how Hans became a superman. They gave him a uniform and they pumped up his ego. He wasn't just a little fellow out of work anymore. He was a member of the master race. Hans and thousands of others like him, all playing a sucker's game. They gambled with other people's liberty, and of course they lost their own. A nation of suckers. Hitler needed these people. There was lots of work to be done. There were trade unions to be smashed, because unions were organized and might offer resistance. There were many political parties in Germany. These the Nazis destroyed. They were determined to smash every organization where people might band together and resist them. There were Jews to be beaten and killed. The Jews were not powerful, but they were a convenient excuse for all the nation's ills. And besides, a Nazi party member could not take over this man's store. Hundreds of Catholics were put in jail because the Catholic Church had strength and could resist the Nazi drive for power. They had split the nation into 100 pieces, and then one by one, they had destroyed the pieces. Over these broken pieces, the Nazis rode into power. One party, one nation, one religion. These men had won their struggle for power. They now ruled all of Germany. But still they had trouble with their oldest and most persistent enemy, the truth. They found that truth does not die easily, and so they decided to abolish truth. One great source of truth is literature, so they burned books, 20 million of them. Many great men in Germany who were spokesmen for truth were jailed or driven from their country. Teachers, writers, scientists. Education was discouraged. In 5 years, college attendance dropped 53%. It was forbidden to listen to a British radio program or read an American newspaper. In Nazi Germany, you had to get your information from Dr. Goebbels. He knew what was best for you. The church was one force in Germany still strong enough to proclaim the truth in public. This Catholic priest was arrested the following day on charges of immorality. The Protestant church also continued to try and fight for truth. The Nazis put this man in a concentration camp. There were others who spoke for truth, and I am proud to say that educators were among them.
And what, may I ask, is an Aryan?
I don't know, my son.
But let us see what our present so-called authorities have to say about him.
They say he is tall, slender, blue-eyed, and blonde. There is no Aryan race. And more important, there is no master race. There are people who may find these ideas convenient, but science cannot support them. There is no scientific proof
that there's any correlation between a man's racial characteristics and his native ability or character. In all racial groups, we find the same range of potentialities. We find idiots and geniuses. We find criminals and philanthropists. We must judge each man as an individual and not by the color of his skin or his eyes or by the length of his nose. Come in, gentlemen. It's comfortable. And remember that there is no master race. That is a scientific truth. Anyone who tells you otherwise is lying.
And so, for all practical purposes, truth had been abolished in Germany. A lot of my German friends wondered what had hit them. How did it happen? Where did it start? It started right here. And this was where it could have been stopped. If those people had stood together, if they had protected each other, they could have resisted the Nazi threat. Together they would have been strong. But once they allowed themselves to be split apart, they were helpless. When that first minority lost out, everybody lost out. They made the mistake of gambling with other people's freedom. Now let's see how those bets paid off. Karl the farmer was gambling on a better life for himself. What he got was extra hours of back-breaking work, as much as 100 hours a week. He was forced to stay on his land and produce what he was told to produce, because now Hitler was preparing for war. For Heinrich, who owned a hardware store, the bet didn't pay off either. 104,000 small businesses were closed in 2 years. And for Hans, conditions hadn't improved any. He had a job now in a munitions factory, but he worked long hours for little pay. The working conditions grew increasingly bad. And even though he didn't like the job, he wasn't permitted to leave it. And when Hitler decided the time was right, Germany went to war. Not by declaring war, but by a carefully prepared sneak attack. Once again, Hitler needed Hans to do his dirty work. Hans was an expert at brutality this time. And Hitler had decided to use Hans and his brutality against other peoples. The Czechs, the Poles, the French, the Russians. But in the crucial test of war, Hitler's race theories didn't pay off. His pure-blooded supermen were defeated by the mongrel armies he despised. By the British of El Alamein. By the Russians at Stalingrad. Then on D-Day by American soldiers of every color and religion, who smashed across the Normandy beaches and drove on through to the heart of Germany. For the misguided Germans who had swallowed the Nazi bait, the Nazi game did not pay off. The continent of Europe was strewn with millions of German bodies, pure Aryan bodies. Karl, the farmer, was left in the snow outside of Moscow. Heinrich stayed in Italy at Salerno. And Hans, who was going to rule the world, got only a little patch of Normandy that he could call his own.
We must never let that happen to us or to our country. We must never let ourselves be divided by race or color or religion, because in this country we all belong to minority groups. I was born in Hungary, you are a Mason. These are minorities. And then you belong to other minority groups too. You are a farmer, you have blues, you go to the Methodist Church. Your right to belong to these minorities is a precious thing. You have a right to be what you are and say what you think, because here we have personal freedom. We have liberty. And these are not just fancy words. This is a practical and priceless way of living.
But we must work at it. We must guard everyone's liberty, or we can lose our own. If we allow any minority to lose its freedom by persecution or by prejudice, we are threatening our own freedom. And this is not simply an idea. This is good, hard common sense. You see, here in America, it's not a question whether we tolerate minorities. America is minorities. And that means you and me. So let's not be suckers. We must not allow the freedom or dignity of any man to be threatened by any act or word. Let's be selfish about it. Let's forget about we and they. Let's think about us.
This is the story of your enslavement. How it came to be, and how you can finally be free. Like all animals, human beings want to dominate and exploit the resources around them. At first, we mostly hunted and fished and ate off the land, but then something magical and terrible happened to our minds. We became, alone among the animals, afraid of death and of future loss. And this was the start of a great tragedy and an even greater possibility. You see, when we become afraid of death, of injury and imprisonment, we become controllable and so valuable in a way that no other resource could ever be. The greatest resource for any human being to control is not natural resources or tools or animals or land, but other human beings. You can frighten an animal, because animals are afraid of pain in the moment. But you cannot frighten an animal with a loss of liberty, with torture or imprisonment in the future, because animals have very little sense of tomorrow. You cannot threaten a cow with torture or a sheep with death. You cannot swing a sword at a tree and scream at it to produce more fruit, or hold a burning torch to a field and demand more wheat. You cannot get more eggs by threatening a hen, but you can get a man to give you his eggs by threatening him. This human farming has been the most profitable and destructive occupation throughout history, and it is now reaching its destructive climax. Human society cannot be rationally understood until it is seen for what it is. A series of farms where human farmers own human livestock. Some people get confused because governments provide healthcare and water and education and roads, and thus imagine that there is some benevolence at work. Nothing could be further from the reality. Farmers provide healthcare and irrigation and training to their livestock. Some people get confused because we are allowed certain liberties and thus imagine that our governments protect our freedoms. But farmers plant their crops a certain distance apart to increase their yields, and will allow certain animals larger stalls or fields if it means they will produce more meat and milk. In your country, your tax farm, your farmer grants you certain freedoms, not because he cares about your liberties, but because he wants to increase his profits. Are you beginning to see the nature of the cage you were born into? There have been four major phases of human farming. The first phase in ancient Egypt was direct and brutal human compulsion. human bodies were controlled, but the creative productivity of the human mind remained beyond the reach of the whip and the brand and the shackles. Slaves remained woefully underproductive and required enormous resources to control. The second phase was the Roman model, wherein slaves were granted some capacity for freedom, ingenuity, and creativity, which raised their productivity. This increased the wealth of Rome, and thus the tax income of the Roman government, and with this additional wealth, Rome became an empire, destroying the economic freedoms that fed its power and collapsed. I'm sure that this does not seem entirely unfamiliar. After the collapse of Rome, the feudal model introduced the concept of livestock ownership and taxation. Instead of being directly owned, peasants farmed land that they could retain as long as they paid off the local warlords. This model eventually broke down due to the continual subdivision of productive land and was destroyed during the enclosure movement when land was consolidated and hundreds of thousands of peasants were kicked off their ancestral lands because new farming techniques made larger farms more productive with fewer people. The increased productivity of the later Middle Ages created the excess food required for the expansion of towns and cities, which in turn gave rise to the modern democratic model of human ownership. As displaced peasants flooded into the cities, a huge stock of cheap human capital became available to the rising industrialists, and the ruling class of human farmers quickly realized that they could make more money by letting their livestock choose their own occupations. Under the democratic model, direct slave ownership has been replaced by the mafia model. The mafia rarely owns businesses directly, but rather sends thugs around once a month to steal from the business owners. You are now allowed to choose your own occupation, which raises your productivity, and thus the taxes you can pay to your masters. Your few freedoms are preserved because they are profitable to your owners. The great challenge of the democratic model is that increases in wealth and freedom threaten the farmers. The ruling classes initially profit from a relatively free market in capital and labor, but as their livestock become more used to their freedoms and growing wealth, they begin to question why they need rulers at all. Ah, well, nobody ever said that human farming was easy. Keeping the tax livestock securely in the compounds of the ruling classes is a three-phase process. The first is to indoctrinate the young through government, quote, education. As the wealth of democratic countries grew, government schools were universally inflicted in order to control the thoughts and souls of the livestock. The second phase is to turn citizens against each other through the creation of dependent livestock. It is very difficult to rule human beings directly through force, and where it can be achieved, it remains cripplingly underproductive, as can be seen in North Korea. Human beings do not breed well or produce efficiently in direct captivity. Ah, but if human beings believe that they are free, then they will produce much more for their farmers. The best way to maintain this illusion of freedom is to put some of the livestock on the payroll of the farmer. Those cows that become dependent on the existing hierarchy will then attack any other cows who point out the violence, hypocrisy, and immorality of human ownership.
Officers positioned Grant face first on the floor with one officer near his head, a second near his back, and a third officer standing nearby. There appeared to be a brief struggle. Then, a two-year veteran BART officer stands, draws his weapon, and fires.
Freedom is slavery, and slavery is freedom. If you can get the cows to attack each other whenever anybody brings up the reality of their situation, then you don't have to spend nearly as much controlling them directly. Those cows who become dependent upon the stolen largesse of the farmer will violently oppose any questioning of the virtue of human ownership, and the intellectual and artistic classes, always and forever dependent upon the farmers, will say to anyone who demands freedom from ownership, "You will harm your fellow cows." The livestock are thus kept enclosed by shifting the moral responsibility for the destructiveness of the violent system to those who demand real freedom. The third phase is to invent continual external threats so that the frightened livestock cling to the protection of the farmers. This system of human farming is now nearing its end. The terrible tragedies of modern Western economic systems has occurred not in spite of, but because of, past economic freedoms. The massive increases in Western wealth throughout the 19th century resulted from economic freedoms. And it was this very increase in wealth that fed the size and power of the state. Whenever the livestock become exponentially more productive, you get a corresponding increase in the number of farmers and their dependents. The growth of the state is always proportional to the preceding economic freedoms. Economic freedoms create wealth, and the wealth attracts more thieves and political parasites, whose greed then destroys the economic freedoms. In other words, freedom metastasizes the cancer of the state. The government that starts off the smallest will always end up the largest. This is why there can be no viable and sustainable alternative to a truly free and peaceful society. A society without political rulers, without human ownership, without the violence of taxation and statism. To be truly free is both very easy and very hard. We avoid the horror of our enslavement because it is so painful to see it directly. We dance around the endless violence of our dying system because we fear the attacks of our fellow livestock. But we can only be kept in the cages we refuse to see. Wake up. To see the farm is to leave it.
Contrary to what many people assume, most of the suffering, injustice, and conflict in the world is not the result of greed, hatred, or intolerance. Instead, most of man's inhumanity to man is the result of one particular belief, one irrational superstition, which is shared by almost everyone, namely, the belief in authority. Most theft, assault, and murder in the world is not carried out by individuals acting on their own malice, but by individuals who were obeying the orders of so-called governments. The worst atrocities in history were the result of a very small number of truly nasty people acquiring positions of power, combined with a very large number of average people who viewed those few people as authority, and so felt obligated to obey their commands. It has always been the law-abiding taxpayers who have funded and empowered oppressive regimes. The problem is that most good people have fallen for the lie that when aggression, robbery, and control is committed in the name of law, then it is legitimate and moral, even necessary. The belief in authority tricks basically good people into going along with legalized injustice. Most children are taught that obedience to authority is a virtue, and even most adults still think that bowing to a ruling class, which they call obeying the law, is what makes someone a good person. It's not. On the contrary, being a moral human being requires understanding right and wrong, and doing the right thing, even when authority tells you not to. The basic rules for being a good person are very simple. Treat every other person as if he owns himself, because he does. This means you shouldn't attack, rob, or otherwise initiate violence against anyone. In other words, you shouldn't start a fight. If someone else attacks you, you have the right to defend yourself, but no one has the right to be an attacker. Badges, uniforms, and so-called laws do not change this fact. There is virtue in respecting the rights and property of others. There is no virtue in obeying the law just for the sake of being obedient. Sometimes a law happens to match morality, such as laws against murder. But the reason murder is bad is not because politicians wrote a law about it. Murder is wrong because it violates the self-ownership of the victim. If laws against murder were repealed tomorrow, or if a law was passed commanding some people to commit murder, as has happened over and over again throughout history, murder would still be wrong. Indeed, there are many historical examples where the good people were the criminals, the lawbreakers, the rebels, and traitors to their so-called governments. When the law goes against what is moral and righteous, then it is the duty of every decent person to disobey and resist. These days, few dare to stand up to any supposed authority. Instead, people are trained to participate in elections and politics, which amounts to begging the masters to please be nicer, as if we shouldn't do what we know is right unless and until the politicians give us permission to. Not only that, but decent people are also tricked into believing that it is perfectly acceptable and righteous to control and rob their neighbors as long as they do it by way of voting and the political process. In short, the political process is designed to dupe the people into cooperating with and even demanding their own subjugation and the subjugation of everyone else. As long as those in power can trick people into arguing over how government power should be used, arguing over who should be robbed and how much, arguing over who should be bossed around and controlled, then the masses will always be at war with each other and will keep empowering tyrants and throwing away their own freedom. Even otherwise good people feel no guilt about condoning that their fellow man be robbed and dominated, because they've been taught that when extortion and coercion is called taxation and law enforcement, that it is not only moral and proper, but is necessary for society. Only very rarely do people recognize that the only way they will ever have freedom themselves is to allow everyone else, including people they don't like, don't approve of, and have little in common with, to also be free. As long as people keep playing the game where they argue over which power-happy political opportunist should be running things, there will be no freedom or justice for anyone. Every government in the world legalizes aggression and extortion. Every so-called tax or other law is a threat of violence. On one level, everyone knows this. The politicians, by way of the legislative process, tell everyone else what they must do or what they may not do, and anyone who gets caught disobeying will be robbed or caged in the name of the law. The old notion of the divine right of kings has changed into the divine right of politicians, with similar results. Indeed, the belief in government is essentially a religion, the most dangerous and destructive religion ever. Hundreds of millions of human beings have been murdered by their own governments, many millions more have died in government-created wars, and billions more have been robbed, harassed, terrorized, and otherwise forcibly dominated and oppressed by ruling classes, including democratically elected constitutional governments. Yes, sometimes agents of government will try to stop other aggressors, but every government is itself a gang of thieves and thugs. In fact, private thieves could never steal anywhere near the amount of wealth the government confiscates via taxes, and the wars waged by government completely dwarf the murder and violence committed by private thugs. Of course, there are nasty people in the world, and there still would be without government. And the good people need to have the ability and willingness to defend against such people. But organizing for self-defense is not, in and of itself, what government is. Instead, government is the idea that some people can have the moral right to rule everyone else, that constitutions, elections, and other rituals give some people an exemption from basic morality and make it okay for them to boss around other people under threat of force. The idea that we need to give a group of people permission to forcibly rob and control us so they can protect us from those who might forcibly rob and control us is ridiculous. And yet most people believe exactly that. They believe that we need government, the biggest thug and thief around, to protect us from thugs and thieves. To make this sound less absurd, the people are taught nonsensical mythology about democracy, representative government, and the consent of the governed. But there are several ways to easily prove that government cannot possibly be legitimate, never has been, and never will be. For example, people obviously cannot delegate rights they don't have themselves. If you do not have the right to rob your neighbor on your own, then you can't possibly give such a right to some public official, nor can anyone else. No election, no constitution, no political process can make robbery and extortion moral and righteous, even if politicians first do a bunch of complicated pseudo-religious rituals and then call the robbery law and taxation. It is also easy to prove that the only thing government adds to society, or will ever add to society, is more immoral violence. In short, anything that is inherently righteous, people being productive, working together, voluntarily cooperating and organizing, defending themselves from attackers and thieves, these things don't require any special authority. You don't need a badge or a uniform. You don't need to be elected or appointed in order to have the right to do things which are already righteous and good. The only thing that so-called authority is needed for is to do things which normal people do not have the right to do, to try to authorize and legitimize acts that would be wrong if done by normal people. In other words, so-called authority is nothing more than permission to do bad things.
You are watching Paradigm Shift in Educational Comedy Special Edition presentation designed for broadcasting on Conscious Consumer Network Independent TV. These special edition segments are meant to take the best of the best of Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy, mixing and mashing the clips and redesigning them into a brand new derivative work for the purpose of both informing you and entertaining you. Each show will also air on the PSEC documentary YouTube channel 1 week after they are streamed on CCN. It is our intention to inspire others to view the negative as a positive opportunity for positive change, because without compassion in our actions, one is merely aware, but not necessarily awake. A platform of compassion and not falling for divide and conquer division tactics is the only way to bring in a new and better world that is not run by psychopaths. Speaking of psychopaths, we are here with Slick Willie, aka former President Bill Clinton. Mr. Clinton, has the rise of compassion within the human spirit caused any interference with your ability to rape women and molest children? And has this created any unforeseen phenomenon while you and your buddies worship that funky-looking stone owl during your cremation of care ceremonies at Bohemian Grove?
Well, Mr. Kelso, I tell you, this new conscious energy has been really hard on me and my wife, Hillary. It's making it very, very difficult for me to do my presidential ex-presidential rape campaign. It's making it very difficult for me to keep it up anymore. I got to keep a line of Viagra constantly flowing into my veins to get it up. I can't even rape children like I used to. I've partaken in a lot of crazy shenanigans over the years, but 2017 has been one triggering year for me and the old pig. I mean, Hillary, my wife has become uglier and uglier and uglier. I have to put a bag over her head just to stick my slick in there. I'm afraid I might get diseased. After all, she's been on the campaign so long, she's starting to get AIDS or some sort of contraction of some sexual disease, that carpet munching pig. It just drives me nuts. My daughter, she's out banging more dicks than I know what to do with, including mine. My buddy Dick Cheney, we went out on a hunting trip, not a hunting accident. He has a tendency to have those every now and again out around the Bohemian Grove grounds, and these energies have been so harsh that the gun accidentally malfired and shot my dick off, and I had to get surgery done. It's now this robotic replacement now, and it sometimes has an electronic spasm and goes out of control, and I can't fucking stop it. It's like the Slick 5000. But as to the political stage, it's very confusing. Vladimir makes fun of me. He likes to leave uranium-crusted dog shit on my porch. And he likes to harass me and make fun of me and laugh at me and tell me that I'm a loser, that I lost the election. And, you know, he calls me a little bitch boy. It really hurts my feelings. And, you know, I thought I was going to be able to rub it in his face. I was going to rub it in Putin's face. I'm really triggered. These energies are really triggered, but it's not fair. It's not fair. My wife should have been the president, Madam President. I should have been the first man, I mean, the first bitch. I mean, the first whore. I mean, the first man. I want to be screwing interns again. Not even a drip of Viagra on IV can help me anymore. I'm just losing my mind. It's just getting crazy for me. I just can't do it. I feel like I'm going insane, like my body's corroding and collapsing on me. I just can't do it. Now I'm on.
Oh my God, I think he's dead. Dave, I think you killed Clinton.
So much for a new world order, but based on what he was describing, sounds like maybe there's a bit of new world odor going on.
His corpse looks like a bag of odors and tricks. Yeesh. Gonna have to clean that shit up. Oh, and now it's leaking Viagra-encrusted diarrhea all over my floor. I'm shit in educational comedy.
Situational comedy. Yeah, well, there you have it, folks. The rise of compassion is just taking those psychopaths and just, they're just becoming triggered little zombies that are just, yeah. Although don't worry, we'll be seeing Bill again. I'm sure they got a clone of him in the frozen locker, you know, someplace, or so they say. It's your heart and soul, it's your flesh and bones, don't you let it go. You're the storm I find, burst up through my sky, take it all control, it's your heart and soul. Your heart and soul.
shining tonight. We'll be shining, we'll be shining, we'll be shining tonight. We'll be shining.